Hi, I'm Mark Fitzgerald, and I'm going to talk to you today about alternate randomization ratios. So what are we talking about an alternative to? Well, our standard trial is going to use a one-to-one randomization. For every patient that we put on the control arm, we put one patient on the experimental treatment arm and just balance things out. It's a nice, easy trial, especially if you need to do something like stratification. So for every patient that you put on the treatment arm that has a certain biomarker, you put one patient with that same biomarker on the control arm. So nice and easy way to stratify, but that's not a big stumbling block. The real reason that we do one-to-one randomization is for statistical power. That's usually the primary motivation for why we want to do one-to-one randomization. What's our best chance of detecting a treatment effect if there really is a treatment effect? So this is what a typical power curve is going to look like. Suppose that we've designed our trial so that we've got 80% power at a one-to-one randomization ratio. Well, what happens if we change that randomization? Instead of putting 50% of the patients on treatment and 50% on control, suppose we adjust that and we do 3-to-2 randomization. So for every 3 on treatment, we do 2 on control. So a 60% allocation to the treatment arm. Well, what happens to our power? It drops off a little bit. So in this particular example, it drops from 80% down to 77.5%. And if you keep going, if you make that randomization ratio a little more extreme, if we go out to 2-to-1, where 67% of our patients are getting randomized to the treatment arm, then our power drops to 75%. Keep going out to 3-to-1, it drops to 68%, and it keeps going and getting worse and worse as we move that randomization ratio out. All right, well, is that a big deal? Well, it can be a very big deal. 3% chance at winning a trial, that's something that you may do a lot of work to get to. So we don't want to just give that up for nothing. So one-to-one randomization is a really good idea if power is your primary concern. However, we need to be careful about what our assumptions are. So suppose that we're in a situation where the control arm and the treatment arm don't respond exactly the same way in terms of the variation that we see in the data. So suppose that there's something about the treatment arm that not only changes the mean, that changes how the subject responds, but it also changes how much variation there is in that response. So here's an example of a power curve where the standard deviation that we observe for the final endpoint in the treatment arm is double that of what we have in the control arm. And now we see that the power curve doesn't look quite the same. We don't have this peak at the 50% randomization ratio. The peak actually occurs at 67% at a 2-to-1 randomization ratio. So really what we're trying to balance here, it isn't that we need to have the same number of patients in each arm. What we need is we need to have an equal amount of information between the treatment and an equal amount of information in the control. So information is a little bit different than subjects. In many situations, it is the same as the same number of subjects. If we're utilizing controls from a different experiment, so either one that's going on concurrently, or we have historical controls and we're going to try to borrow some information from those previous studies to bring into this one, our effective sample size on the control arm might be much bigger than what we're actually allocating the patients in this particular trial. If you want to see more information about how to borrow from historical controls and some of the other issues that come up with that, see Kurt Veeley's talk on this here on the Berry Consultants website. So there are other issues besides just statistical power, though. That's not the only thing that we may care about in a trial. So for example, maybe we're not really so worried about proving efficacy. Maybe we're pretty sure that we've got plenty of sample size to demonstrate that the treatment is effective. But we have other things that we have to worry about, like safety. And maybe we need to make sure that we've got a sufficient safety database to be able to move forward to the next phase, rolling out this treatment. So for example, suppose that you're required to have 3,000 patients on your treatment and follow them long-term to understand whether or not you've got any rare side effects that you're gonna have to worry about. You might need to do this in something that's gonna be rolled out to a large population like a vaccine. Well, maybe it's not the best use of your resources to allocate one-to-one within this study for the sake of getting a database of 3,000. Maybe you don't need 3,000 treatment patients and 3,000 control patients. Maybe you can get away with a different randomization ratio, save some money, and still have plenty of power to prove the efficacy that you need. Another consideration is what if one of your goals is really treating the patients that are in this trial? So if you're talking about a really deadly disease, if you're talking about a rare disease where you actually have most of the people who have this condition are actually in your trial, you may be a lot more concerned about what's happening to these patients that are in your trial. And so consider a case where you've got a 15% survival rate on the control and your treatment you think is going to be better than that. You're pretty sure it doesn't do harm. Well, let's think about what's going to happen to, say, the 500 patients that we put into this trial. Well, we're going to have more survivors if we allocate more to a treatment that works. We don't know if the treatment works. That's why we're running the trial. But if we think at worst the treatment is the same as the control, then at the worst we're going to do is have the same number of survivors. So we can only improve things by allocating higher rates to the treatment group in this condition. Perhaps this isn't as big a concern. If the bigger concern is making sure that this treatment gets rolled out to a larger population, you'll have more lives to save. In that regard, I won't try to delve into the bioethics of the bigger picture here, but to say that it's a little bit more complicated when you're considering what's happening to these real people that are in your trial. But if you want to think about this from a patient perspective, if I'm a patient coming into this, and suppose that I've got options. So suppose I've got options of two different clinical trials that I might go into, and one is randomizing 1-to-1, and another one's randomizing 3-to-1. And I don't know anything about these treatments. I'm just somebody who's suddenly got this condition and I want to be treated. Well, I might have a very strong preference for going to the one that randomizes 3-to-1 because I know I have a much better chance of getting a treatment that may or may not work, but I know I have a better chance of being on a treatment that may work. And so perhaps what this leads to is a much higher accrual rate for your trial by making it more, giving your patient more incentive to come into the trial. And what's the effect of that? Well, there's definitely some very big benefits to faster accrual. So your trial is going to complete sooner. And now, is that worth it? Well, you have a risk of lower power. So you may have a treatment that works that you don't find out works because you have lower power, but you're going to complete this sooner. And the value of that time that you save could be really big. So from a business perspective, how much is that extra year that you're on market worth, especially if you're up against a patent expiry? Also, it could be that you don't have to take a cut in your power. It could be that the savings that you're going to get in terms of the time costs can be converted to an increased sample size, and maybe you can actually maintain your power. So just some closing thoughts. When we think about designs that are pulled off the shelf, like a 1-to-1 randomization, we should always think about what are our assumptions. Do they make sense? And maybe the default design was optimal for what it was originally set up for, but your assumptions may not quite match that. And remember that power isn't everything. When you're talking about a clinical trial, there are other things to consider: safety, the patient preferences, and all these other pieces that really come into the bigger picture of what it is that you're performing. I hope you found this info on alternate randomization ratios interesting, and thanks for watching.